It's an awesome time to be in the Lord. It's an awesome time to be as well in the principle of the matter of the work that Christ calls us out to do. Amen. I'm excited to be here with y'all this morning. Amen. You know, if all the buttons aren't, you know, pushed right, hey, you know what? You might have to do it again. Come on now. Are you listening? Let's do it again. But I was just giving a shout out and just thanking all of y'all for tuning in and being here with me and just rejoicing into the things of God and all the things that He's doing. Amen. We're just here to bless the name of the Lord. We're here to glorify the name of the Lord with our lives. Amen. With everything that He's called us out to do and as well to be. Amen. That's where the exciting of it is, that it's just not something that, you know how when they say that grandma don't have no teeth and she just kind of bumping at the lips, you know, no, it's not just the bumping at the lips, it's the action behind the word of everything that is moving forward. You may feel like, well, I'm doing a little, or maybe I'm not doing as much that I would like to do. But, you know, little is much when God is in it. Come on now. Little is much. And that's what I want you to receive here today. That little is much when God is in it, church. Because, you know, a lot of people can be doing a lot of things. Amen. But if God isn't in it, believe me, just like the word says, that anything is like chaff. It's just going to be burned up. Why? Because it's not founded on God. Come on now. The Lord is not in the picture. But if He is in the picture on even the little things to the great, big, huge, humongous things, then praise be the glory to God. But if you're doing a lot of, you know, washy works and works that they're making you feel good, but literally, is God in the picture? You know, and that's what I want to share with you today. And that's what, you know, one of the things that I've always actually shared with you, you know, is that the Lord motivates me. He gives me the word of encouragement. He gives me, you know, the word to give out, because I don't want the words of my own self. I want the words that He has for me to literally give to each and every one of y'all. You know, I wrote out, because those of y'all are knowing I'm as well as I'm in still school. And even on this summer break, we're still in school. Amen. We have final exams already coming up. And I'm excited that one of the assistants had said, you know, she said, not to worry, Sister Tina. She said, we're not gonna go through, you know, given the assessments of the assignments until August the 3rd and 5th, which was gonna be that Friday. And I thought that it was already that Friday. I was like, I was ready. My thumbs were ready. I was booming. I was like, okay, you know, but I'm not understanding, you know, the whole scenario of the questions and everything that has to be given. But the more that, you know, I just kind of brought it down a notch. Come on now. I brought it down a notch and just really just kind of soaked into what was really given out to the understanding of the matter. And everything's going to be all right. Amen. I understood it. And that's what I was trying to share with, I think it was either my husband or my son, you know, that that is, well, we can't just go into things of the spirit and just grab a hold of them and just, you know, I don't want to say it, really getting the downloading of the revelation of what God is truly talking and telling His people. Amen. And as I was sharing, when this isn't just regular, okay, I'm going to a university, or, you know, I'm going to learn about math and reading, and you know, it's not a regular school, amen. It's, you're talking about the school of the prophet. So really, to me, it's almost like it's not like it is, you know, the school of the spirits, because you really have to be in tune in the spirit. You have to be prayed up. You have to be prayed in and prayed out and prayed all the way around. And, you know, and it seems like we actually go through the practical of a lot of things, how God sets up people, because we have to integrate other people outside ourselves. We have to give word as well to those that we come in contact with. So what I'm trying to say, church, that it's a work as well, and God is in it. Amen. We see the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. We see that God is answering prayer. Amen. And he is reaffirming and confirming all the things of the words that are getting, which we call them prophetic words. And those words are the ones that come to life and come to life personally as well as into our lives. You know, I'm sharing all of this because, like I shared with you beginning, that you may feel that you're not doing much, but little is much when God is in it. You know, and I'm going to come into the word of scripture here today, as the Lord had led me to read here out of the book of Acts, amen, in chapter 16, and that's where we're here at this morning. And as I was receiving the word, you know, the Lord had brought me to the visions of a man, amen. And through these visions of a man, we know this is Apostle Paul, that has Timothy has joined them to be together and to go into these specific areas where they went to the churches, where the faith of the people can grow, amen, because the word of God is being preached. Come on now. And so we see here that now Paul has companions and he's traveling throughout the region. Amen. And he's saying that he has been kept by the Holy Spirit by preaching the word of God. Amen. And that's how we're maintaining. That's how, when we're going and we're doing, amen, not only in our Jerusalem, but in our Samaria, amen, and all the way into every parts of the earth, amen, wherever the Lord ordained you. Maybe it's in your job. Maybe it's in the highways, in the byways. Hey, it can be there in the middle of Walmart. I mean, you know, God is open to use you when you're open to be used by God. Amen. And so that's important, because we just don't need a pulpit to be able to share the word of God. We share the word of God as God gives it to us, and we minister to those that we are in contact with all and throughout our day. Amen. To be that witness of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see here this man of God being in this place, being led by the Holy Spirit. Come on, God, that's very important, because even though he was being led by the Holy Spirit, amen, they came across some things that had happened to them. And you could probably say, well, if they were so caught up in the spirit, how is it that the other could happen? Amen. But they're just heeding the voice of the Lord. You know, there in verse 10, it says, after Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. You know, literally, there was other word in scripture where it literally said that the Holy Spirit did not let them to lead them to go where they were going to go to deliver the word. But here we see that is not the case in this case. No, it says they were getting ready to go to Macedonia. Amen. As God has called them to preach the gospel there. Now, the highlight of the matter here is in verse 13, as we come upon a lady named Lydia, amen, that she was a dealer. Hello. It's like, all right, a dealer. So to me, that means that, you know, she was a working woman. She was a working woman. And boy, it seems like she just kind of had it all together. So we're going to read the word of scripture there in verse 13 as the Lord leads. Amen. It says, on the Sabbath, we went outside the city gate of the river, where we expected to find a place of prayer. We sat down and we began to speak to the woman who had gathered there. Come on now. So this, they were looking for a place of prayer. Amen. And it was on the outside of the gate of a river. So they were in tune with the things of the Spirit. Amen. And it says, one of those listening was a woman named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth from the city of Thyatira, who was a worshiper of God. So to me right there, not only was she a dealer, amen, in purple cloth. In other words, she was a worker. This was her business. It was like if she had a clothesline, you know, that she did sewing or maybe some type of just selling, amen, that of these purple cloth. But besides that, the word of God shares as well as she was a worshiper of God. So we see that she as well was a dealer and a worshiper. And here I'm thinking, okay, maybe that's the reason why she was at that place of prayer. Amen. That place by the gate of the river as well. The Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. So we could see, even though she had some things going right, there was still a message to be delivered unto her heart. It says, when she and the members of her household were baptized, okay, so now they took it up an extra notch, that not only that they received salvation, but now her and her household were baptized. Amen. It says, and she invited us unto her home. So not only did she invite them to her home, but she was baptized. If you consider me a believer in the Lord, she said, come and stay at my house. And she persuaded us. So as we see here, she was still letting them know, if you have any questions or if you have any doubts, you know, I want you to know that you can come and stay at my house. Amen. If you consider me a believer now in the Lord, hey, my house is open to you. Amen. My house is open because I've opened up my heart. I've opened up, you know, my soul, my mind, and who I am. And if you consider me now a believer, I want you to come to stay with us. You know, I believe she realized that it would be a privilege to take in the woman or the man of God into her house. And she persuaded them. Amen. And so that's why she stayed. as we read on, we see that once they come to the place of prayer, they were met up with a girl that was used for foretelling. In other words, she knew things about demons. She was used by the devil. Amen. But she spoke that of the Paul and Silas about them knowing who they were, and they were shouting, or she was shouting and saying that these are men, they're servants of the Most High God. So see, it doesn't matter who your enemies are, because when they know the truth of the matter, hey, God's name is going to be praised. God's name is going to be lifted up. Amen. But we see here the apostle Paul, it said that after many of days that she just kept up on this, it troubled him so much that he just turned around and he said, "In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her." Amen. And when he did that, the money that the owners of this girl knew that they weren't going to be able to get no money out of her no more. And so, you know what? They got thrown in prison. Can you imagine setting this girl free after her blabbing her mouth? Because it says here that Paul was troubled of her just continually saying that. In other words, I believe he was battling in his mind, hey, you know what? I'm not the Lord. I'm not the Savior. I'm just the messenger. You said it right. You know what? That these are the servants of the Most High God. But he had to put her in her place. And it wasn't her. It was that spirit that was just agitating on them. Amen. But literally, by him, through the Holy Spirit and through the power, the anointing of God. Amen. When he delivered this young girl, it took him to the place of jail, where literally they put them in the inner jail. They fastened their feet with stocks. In other words, those stocks, I don't know if you remember in the old days, they're chains, and they put the stocks to where they cover your ankle or your feet, and they're real heavy. También pesados. And they're real thick. And there's some that they would use around the neck. There's some that they would use around their arms, around their legs. Because you know what? They, seeing them with this power that they didn't understand. And because of that, it took them to a place where it was not, how do you say, they weren't celebrating them. They were celebrating them for the fact that they were put in prison. But see, one of the things that they didn't know, that when it came about midnight, come on now, y'all say midnight, because it came about midnight that Paul and Silas were praying and they were singing these hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. So that's already a key there. That even though they were in a space of trouble, others were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. In other words, the foundations that they had were so for sure, because they were used to all the shaking and the baking. You see what I'm saying? They were being used to being filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with the anointing of God. But he said, you know what? This that caused this violent earthquake, that the foundations of the prison were shaken. So my question to you is, are your foundations being shaken? Oh, Jesus! Are your foundations being shaken? You know, because they're here in the truth of the matter of fact. And so maybe that where you are not sure of, God is saying, you know what? We're going to release, just like that spirit that was on that young girl. Come on now, it's fresh revelation. That same spirit that was on that young girl that was just to make the money. You know what? Is being removed right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Because if your foundations were being shaken, then maybe we weren't quite on that sure foundation. Are we listening? Are we listening? And so that is something as well that I want to share with you. The foundations of the prison were shaken. And it was for those to hear. It was for those to see. And it was for those to listen, to bring a sure foundation. Through prayer, through worship, through singing hymns, through singing these songs. Amen. And it says at once. It didn't say yesterday or the day before. No, it says at once. All the prison doors, they flew open. And everybody's, it just didn't say theirs. Everybody's chains came loose. It says the jailer woke up. And when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword. And he was about to even kill himself, because he thought that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, don't harm yourself, because we're all here. In other words, they were so filled with the power and the anointing of God. Nobody wasn't thinking about running out. They were all thinking about just running in. But running into the spirit of things. Not running out, but running in. Amen. And those that didn't quite understand it, he's saying, you know what? Don't harm yourself. It's not time to harm yourself. It's time to rely. It's time to trust on the things of God. It's time that God is calling us out to have reaffirmation and transformation of our foundations to be made sure. Amen. Let me tell you why, church. And this is all scripture based, because we're going down the road of salvation. It says the jailer called for lights, rushed in, and he fell trembling before Paul and Silas. And then he brought them out and he had asked, sir, what must I do to be saved? See, when our foundations are being shaken, it's for us to say, what must I do to be saved? Are we crying out to God? Are we asking the Lord, Father, if there's any area, places or spaces in my life that need to be made right, Father God, make it right. Make a complete salvation of the heart, the soul, my body, my mind. You know, they replied to him, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. And that is my answer to you as well. I'm replying to you to believe. To believe in the Lord Jesus. And you will be saved. Not only you, church, but you and your household. See, when they got taken into that jail, those stocks and those bars, it didn't affect them. What affected them is those that were around them, because they didn't have what they had inside of them. And as they began to break out and literally praise and worship the Lord, it made an impact not only in their lives, but in the lives of others around them. They seen the difference, that literally that they wanted to receive salvation into their lives. Amen. Salvation into their lives. This is, and they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all the others in the house, that the hour of the night the jailer took them, he washed their wounds, and then immediately he and all of his family were baptized. So not only did they receive salvation, church, but they were baptized. Hallelujah. Into the family and into the things of the Lord Jesus Christ. It says that the jailer brought them into his house and he set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole family. Is that not the very same thing? The woman, Miss Lydia, is that not the very same confirmation of her saying that if you consider me a believer in the Lord, she said, come and stay at my house. This was the same thing that this jailer did. He said he was so filled with joy. He says because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole family, amen, were saved. And then the word of God says that when it was daylight, the magistrate sent the officers to the jailer with the order, release those men. Check this out. This is the part that I think that's really funny, because we see the magistrates, they threw them in the jail after doing something for the Lord. Amen. Because they went into these circumstances, literally, people got saved. Families got saved. And it made such an earmark that not only did they got saved, but they got baptized. Come on now. And when these magistrates, these officers, they told him, release those men. The jailer told Paul, the magistrates have ordered that you and Silas be released. Now you can leave. Go in peace. So not only did they did a work and setting that little girl free, come on now, but they did a bigger work and bringing salvation and baptisms into the homes. It says, but Paul said to the officers, it's like him saying, they beat us publicly without a trial, even though we are Roman citizens. They threw us into the prison, and now they want to get rid of us quietly. He said, no, let them con themselves and escort us out. The officers reported this to the magistrates, and when they heard that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens, they were alarmed. In other words, they were of their own people. It says, and they came and appeased them, and they escorted them from the prison, requesting them to leave the city. And after Paul and Silas came out of the prison, they went to Lydia's house, where they met with the brothers and they encouraged them when they left. So you know what? What happens in the beginning, it's better at the end. Those that are accusing you, work out the process. Work out the process and let God just deliver you through all those times of those accusations. Amen. And you know what? Go in peace. Go in peace. Because if you brought even accusations even upon your own life, you know what? God is saying, go in peace. By doing my work, it may take you to go through some harder processes. But you know what? We are believers. And God, just like Paul and Silas, by praying and singing those hymns, breaks those stocks. They will break those chains of any bondages upon our lives. You could say, you know what? All I've been doing is good. All I've been doing is good. But yet it put me into the prison. In other words, you know, it put you into a harder circumstances even when you were doing good. And by the light of the matter, even if you're in that hard place, if you begin to praise and worship the Lord and put the perspective right, God will bring you out. And you know what? It's going to be better. It's going to be better because those that you've impacted around you will bring forth salvation. It will bring forth healing. It will bring forth deliverance. It will bring forth setting the captive free. It will be for bringing baptism. Just like the jailer said, and just like Lydia said, me and my whole household are saved. Amen. Hallelujah, church. You know, I just really felt led to share. I know that it's a, you know, long-winded, but I believe that every action and place of word, you know, brings forth revelation of the lives of people, of those who are listening. Amen. And I could see, and I know that sometimes those areas may be troublesome. But I'm letting you know, church, that as we trust in the Lord, that it's in the power of His might that we lean not on our own understanding. But we acknowledge Him in all our ways, and He's the one that directs our path. He will direct our paths because He's the blessed giver. Amen. Hallelujah, church. I pray that this word have been a blessing unto you. And as not only as we prayed about it and read about it, amen, that we will apply the word, amen, that maybe you're in a hard place, prayer and praise, amen. That's a praise pack there. It's the P-O-M-P. And on top of that, one more P, because you got to add the power. Amen. God will give us the power as well as the anointing to break those yokes of bondage. Amen. So church, have an excellent day. Thank you for flying with me today. Amen. Cruzando fronteras con una voz alerta. Here with Tina Viesca. Amen. Crossing those borders with a voice of alert. Thank you, church. Until next time, amen. Amen. Thank you for those prayers. Hallelujah. Amen.
I left my fear by the side of the road. Hear you speak, you won't let go. Fall to my knees as I lift my hands to pray. God, every reason to be here again. Father's heart that draws me in. And all my eyes want to see is a glimpse of you. All I need.